Good evening and thank you for joining us. You're welcome to Sunday Interview. I'm your host, Grevazio Zulu. Now, public procurement of goods and services is one of the biggest functions of government. But this function has been riddled with corruption and unethical practice, causing the nation and indeed the public to lose billions of kwacha through cartels and overpricing. Controlling officers, together with procurement officers, have often conspired to defraud government of huge sums of money. The Auditor General's report has year in and year out identified weaknesses in the procurement system as one of the major challenges causing loss of public funds, with government spending trillions of kwacha on projects and with procurement being the anchor of this expenditure. Many are asking, is there a way of enhancing accountability, transparency and fairness in the procurement process to plug the leakage on public expenditure? Join me as I speak to the Zambian Institute of Purchasing and Supply President, Chibwe, Mwelwa. Sir, thank you for coming.
Thank you. I'm happy to be here.
Well, let's begin with a general question. What is Zambia Institute of Purchasing and Supply? What does the institute stand for?
Thank you, Grevazio. Zambia Institute of Purchasing and Supply is an act of parliament, which was enacted in 2003. It's actually ZIPS Act number 12 of 2003. And its mandate basically is to regulate the procurement professionals. Any person that is working in the supply chain function in Zambia must be regulated. That means that the institute will provide or act as somebody that is going to certify, you know, check people that work and certify them, ensure that they are trained, ensure that they conduct their business appropriately, and that the government or private sector would get value for their money. The mandate is not only to public procurement, but also private procurement.
Basically, I was going to ask you where you draw your membership from. Do you draw them from the public, private sector?
Members of ZIPS, according to the Act, must be any person that is working in the supply chain function, whether in government or private. Every person who is participating in this function must be regulated by ZIPS.
So when we talk about purchasing and supply, we're basically talking procurement. I want you to explain, what is the importance of procurement to the economy?
Okay. First of all, when you talk about supply and supply, purchasing and supply, you're actually talking about procurement, yes, and stores. Okay. But let me give you some examples for you to understand the importance of this function. First of all, when you talk about public procurement, you may be aware that the cost of doing business is actually managed by supply chain. For the GDP, if I tell you, for the GDP for Zambia or for any developing country, is somewhere between 10, 15, 30% of the GDP controlled by public procurement. So it means that every activity, it's contributing to the GDP of about 15%. And when you see countries developing, for instance, like ours, you know, taking roads to rural areas, you know, building universities, building bridges, building hospitals, undertaking any infrastructure or any other works in government, actually that is attributable to supply chain professionals. So they undertake that process to make sure that government gets value for their money. In the private sector, if I may talk about that, even for public procurement, for instance, the budget, Mr. Mtati's budget is primarily controlled by public procurement. You know, I mean, the austerity measures he was mentioning, all the four principles he mentioned, will actually be actioned by buyers in public procurement. If we speak about private sector, for instance, if I may give you an example of the mines, for instance, or any manufacturing sector, if you understand this, let's imagine that the cost of production is a dollar, okay? In the production system, then 60% or 60 cents of that is actually due to procurement. So it means, if I may explain that, so if you have, for instance, you have a selling price, okay, less production cost, you have gross profits, right? So the production cost is actually 60 to 80% cost of production, I mean cost of procurement. So it means that if you needed to make more money or more profits in that environment, you have to deal with procurement because it's contributing 70% of the cost of production, you know, less the selling price to the profit margin that you have. So it means, therefore, if you work for the mines, for instance, where the selling price is fixed. Okay, is the selling price of copper is determined by some people in London, the London Metal Exchange, and you have to make sure to make a profit from the cost of production when you sell that particular ton of copper. So the people in production can actually undertake the process, but the production cost will be impacted, 60% of that cost, by procurement. So it underpins the importance of procurement, both in private and public sector.
That probably underscores the reason why ZIPS was formed and why you exist. But now, you have been for a long time warning institutions and business houses and employers against using unqualified procurement officers, mm-hmm. which of course is a major detriment on your performance. Mm-hmm. How rampant is this problem?
I think it's a big problem, Grevazio, and it has many reasons if you think about it. But you know, let me give you a history of where you're coming from. First of all, procurement is a latecomer in strategic thinking. Basically, the first PhD person in procurement is about around 1940s. So it's a new function, but it's a function that is rapidly becoming very important. And so in those days, we didn't have degrees from universities in procurement. I did my master's myself in London maybe 15 years ago, but in Zambia, it is actually now when you are seeing people being trained in procurement, to a level where you decide to go and do procurement. So what was happening was, somebody used to be taken to stores, for instance, if you are non-performing in any function, the mines would say, take him to stores. Or if there's some manager wants to find a job for his relative who came from the village, the first thing to do is take him to stores. So we had inherited people like that in the and so we began to have problems in executing such an important function, but having people are not trained. And that has been endemic in the process. So when people began to realize the importance of this, that you cannot sustain your business if you don't have appropriate personnel in procurement. You cannot compete in the business if you don't have appropriate in personnel. So they began to change. But that process has taken long because most companies would rather have their security for them for their own personal reasons. So it is very, very rampant in our organization, even in Zambia, that most people prefer to use untrained people so that they can actually have a hold on them.
But have you been able to flush out some of these unscrupulous people masquerading as procurement officers, untrained?
Yes. In fact, that motivated, if you like, the creation of ZIPS, okay, by the parliament and by the government then, of late Levi Mwanawasa's government. They created ZIPS to go and enforce that in the system. And since then, we had allowed a little bit of affiliates, people that were in the business, maybe not necessarily trained, but they were undertaking the business. Because at that time, in 2003, we didn't have many people that were qualified, in procurement. But today, we have close to 5,000. People that are ready to take up the position and be able to add value to the procurement process, which was not the case then. But we've been trying out to, by trying to make sure that we certify people in government, for instance. Any person that is operating without a license, actually they are operating, they're actually breaking the law. And if we to take the action of what the law depicts, those people can be jailed for 3 years or be fined or both. So what we've done in that line is that we've actually engaged a lawyer because the grace period that was given for that has actually elapsed. So we are going there and making sure that we deal with those issues and take those people that are actually not doing the correct thing, taking them to task, because what that means is if we come to your organization and you find that you are operating without a license, you're actually breaking the law. And the legal firm we have engaged will take it up, to prosecute the person.
Prosecute the individual, prosecute the institution?
Prosecute the person. Because the ZIPS Act does talk about a person who's conducting the procurement. Okay? We are actually in the process of amending the act so we can actually prosecute even the firm that has employed that particular firm, that particular person.
I was going to ask you that as ZIPS, Zambian Institute of Purchasing and Supply, you are backed by law and have the power to regulate your members and prosecutors, you say. But for now, you seem to be among the weakest statutory associations or institutions, I must say. I give an example of the Law Association of Zambia, Engineering Institute of Zambia, ZICA. All these are able to regulate and have an impact on the economy. You are unable to do that, and you've been in existence for 10, 14, over a decade, 14 years. Where is the challenge?
No, it's a correct observation, and that's why I mentioned to you earlier on that we are actually relaunching ZIPS. Okay, when we started, we were beset by a lot of problems, operating was a problem. People didn't want to give up their position, and the act provided for affiliation, which was in there, and that meant that those people were still working, were given a grace period by which they need to transition themselves, so that they actually become buyers. For instance, you go in the mines, you find that maybe a buyer is actually reporting into a finance person or into HR personnel, and different people are doing the functions together. So we've actually started the process as I speak to you. And my interview with you is actually the beginning of this process. We've actually formed last year the compliance committee that is planned to go across the country to inspect each organization, to inspect each government unit even, and to make sure that we actually flush out those people and get the right people to do the business. And we've also approached a number of government units, to help us support that. Because if like PSMD, for instance, we have a discussion with PSMD, and you've told them, the people that you are employing that are not ZIPS members are actually breaking the law. And the permanent secretary there told me, give me the list of those people, I fired them. So we are actually going there, and we're going to submit those names. We're going to take this from all angles. We're going to make sure that those that are working without a license actually are prosecuted, or withdraw withdraw the personnel in there because they are not our members. So you're right in that we've had a lot of problems in there, but we are relaunching this process, and we are also engaged a consultant to actually review the regulations.
Do you have enough professionals? Do you have enough professionals?
Yes,
that's the problem you have.
No, we have a lot of professionals. But let me mention this point. We had ZIPS Act, but ZIPS Act had no regulations. Okay? So last year we engaged a consultant, Ms. Eve Jala, to prepare the regulations to enforce the Act. Okay, because without regulations, it becomes very difficult to enforce the act. If I take the act to prosecute you, and maybe that prosecution fails, it becomes case law. Somebody is going to make reference to that. So the regulations are almost done. We're actually doing that next month, and we'll be launching that. And that regulation clearly indicate what you need to do. And we have reinforced the issue of affiliate. Look, you cannot be an affiliate forever. Because you're an engineer, we allowed you to work, because at the time in 2003, we didn't have many people in the function. You can't be an affiliate forever. So we've changed that. And what we're going to say is, if somebody applies for affiliation, there's a team that is going to look at and review your process. And if indeed you need to be affiliated. And in the case you're affiliated, we need to give you a timeline. You need to come and say, look, I'm actually studying CIPS, I'm studying this procurement, and I'm going to finish in the next one year or 2 years. And we affiliate you for that period. If you don't, we come back and flush you out. So we are making massive investment in that era, in this era, and in that area as well, to make sure that we have people who are trained, because we have a lot of them. We have a lot of them in the streets. But you see, firms would still rather use their relatives to purchase for unknown reasons. So we are coming on afresh, and we are making sure that coming this year, we'll be visiting every organization. We've already employed a compliance team at ZIPS. We have, employed a compliance manager at ZIPS, and we have put aside the funds to travel across the nation.
To ensure you do all the inspections. Now, let me take you to your vision. Your vision is to make purchasing and supply management profession a vehicle and tool for prosperity through prudent procurement and supply. Mm-hmm. Have you fulfilled this?
It's an ongoing process. I'll tell you, there's a lot of our people everywhere in government and in private sector who are doing a marvelous job. We are following exactly what you're saying. The procurement process is defined to add value to organization. you know, what the procurement method that you use, you know, how you conduct the procurement, for the negotiation process, all that adds value to a procurement process. So our mandate is to make sure that those that are manned by our members are actually doing a great job. And Grevazio, I'll use this opportunity to tell you, if there is somebody, for instance, who's working somewhere and they're not members, would love to know about that, because we'd come there and deal with them. And the benefits of having a member, Grevazio, is that if you had a problem, for instance, with ZNBC, you have maybe the procurement manager has a problem, okay? Or you think that your procurement manager is corrupt, for instance, okay? If you take that procurement manager to the police, they'll probably come there, investigate the process, look at, did he follow the process? Was there an evaluation panel? The answer will be yes. You know, did the officer sign? Yes. Was there a procurement committee? Yes. So you're going to tick all those that are going to be yes. It is very difficult to come back and say, this particular buyer is actually corrupt. That's why you've never seen any buyer jailed anywhere. But if you brought that buyer to ZIPS, if you complained, according to Act, that we have a problem with this particular buyer, and ZIPS as a mechanism, we have disciplinary committee that's going to meet, and that's going to look at that particular file, that particular process, and pick out what you and other persons would not pick out, but not a buyer would. So I'm going to look at code of conduct. How did you perform this particular function? Okay. So we will not be saying you are corrupt. We'll be telling you you didn't follow the process. And if you came, or Auditor General's report, or people came and look at that file, they probably see nothing. You know, but if you brought that person at ZIPS, we'll be able to look at this and be able to say, but so you couldn't have done that.
In short, you're saying there are probably two different streams of discipline that can be applied to a procurement officer.
No.
One which is the legal one, enshrined in the law, and one which is able to be detected by your act, by professionals.
Even that is the law. Even because ZIPS Act is law, Revisor. So even that is law. But what you're saying is the disciplinary committee will be able to look at what this particular person did. You know, was this person, you know, following the international best practice in the process? Did he do anything, you know, that is against our profession? And if it's found that you did that, you know, the act is very specific. One, we can actually censure you, for instance, if it's minor. Okay, if you repeat that, we may say maybe this person needs training, or you know, you can attach him to somebody who's senior, you know, to try and mentor that particular person, or we can actually withdraw the license. What the act says, once we withdraw the license from you, you cannot work. So principally, you're fired yourself. Okay. So
we see a lot of that happening in the accounts world. Mm-hmm. In engineering, licenses are revoked. Mm-hmm. We don't see that in your field.
We've done that before. We've actually done that before.
Why are you being soft?
No. We first of all, we've done that before. We've revoked licenses before. You know, I presided over such an issue, but the issue is that we'd want people to complain to ZIPS. We need to report somebody to ZIPS. We cannot just go and start witch hunting, you know, looking for people and trying to punish them. Somebody has to, you know, it's like what you said. Maybe people are not aware about us, but we are properly set up in dealing with that. Because once that license is drawn from you for certain action that you did, you can't work. You can't work in Zambia. You can't work anywhere else. Even in the mines or in public procurement. So the issue is that we're making this appeal, cry and call, if you like, for any member who is deemed to be corrupt by any institutions to report them to ZIPS. We have got a line where we can do that. They can call me straight. They can call the institute. On our website, you can report that, and we'll be able to deal with that. And we'd want to deal with some people, because the act does say, when that happens, we have to publish in the paper that such a person has had their license revoked. And after 1 year, they can reapply and review how that goes. So we believe that it's an issue that people haven't taken advantage of. You know,
people haven't interest in?
Yeah, people, because my own personal view is that it takes two to tango. You know, and people fail to report that. But you're saying if there are genuine people that are corrupt in the process, let them report them to ZIPS.
Now, let's look. I did mention that you've been in existence for 14 years. What do you have to show for your existence?
Okay. ZIPS has actually undertaken a lot of things, which I may itemize for you. First of all, I did mention to you that at the beginning, we had so many people that were not qualified joining the, you know, the profession, and they sent in performing the function without regulated. So ZIPS came up with a program to say, look, these people that are there, can we train them? So ZIPS, as we speak right now, is undertaking a diploma course in purchasing and supply, where we are going to institutions and running the diploma courses. At the moment, actually working on the degree portion, so that we are able to train, because the mandate of ZIPS is to train its members. And this is running. We have over 200 students across Zambia, 800 students across Zambia, and different institutions, Teveta controlled institutions, and they are training our people. We conduct also tailored programs. For instance, we have our members would come in. If we identify an issue, for instance, and there's a gap in there, we actually design programs to go and deal with that issue and making sure that people who are in that particular function are understanding the procurement process. At the moment, we've engaged the consultant, Mr. Njolomba. He's actually looking at the Auditor General's report, for instance. You know, the major issues that are always happening there, you know, is it a training issue? Okay, if it's a training issue, we've asked that, you know, to be designed, and we conduct training to try and help our members. And then also, every year we have a general conference where we bring in international speakers to just try and understand. People begin to realize how important this function is, because one of the things that we discover is people in purchasing and supply themselves, because they are very lowly graded, they have a very strong inferiority complex. You know, some of them come because they are not trained. So we believe that by training people, by partnering with CBU, by partnering with University of Zambia, by partnering with UNILAS, we have actually gone in there and offering degrees at the master's level as well. And ZIPS has been a major player in that part.
Now let's look at the issue of corruption and procurement, corruption and suppliers, corruption and purchasing officers. During his maiden speech, a press conference in November 2015, President Lungu noted that public procurement in Zambia is riddled with corruption, and stating that public procurement had become an avenue through which government had been losing huge sums of funds via cartels and unrealistic pricing of goods and services. People are still manipulating the system. And this involves your members.
Okay. Is your question, is a buyer corrupt? Okay. My answer to that would be yes and no. Let me explain. I'll take time to explain this one, because I think you've asked this question before. Okay. Now, corruption is not resident in the buyer. Corruption is in the process, in the value chain process. I would not sit here as a ZIPS president and tell you there's no corruption in procurement. I'll be lying. There's corruption in the procurement process, but it's not resident in the buyer. And that appreciation is very important. I want to take you through what is called the procurement cycle, Grevazio, so you can begin to understand the ethos around corruption. The buyer, or the end user, let's begin with the end user. The end user defines the specifications, because the buyer does not define what he needs to buy. He has to be told by the end user, you need to buy me a car. Okay, that requisition is made and it goes to a buyer, then the buyer buys. So in the procurement cycle, every process begins by the end user defining what he wants. Now, there could be corruption there. Okay, because the end user can give you specification, Grevazio, that are skewed towards a particular supplier. I can give you, supply me, for instance, 20 bags of trisilicate compound or trisilicate calcium compound. You know, but that is simply give me 20 bags of cement. You see, I can decide to code what I want in the specifications. I can give a specification that is tailoring towards a particular
But when
individual.
You have a professional buyer, they're expected to read through this.
That's why we are saying employ professional people. Okay.
Corruption still continues.
No. I'm giving you the process. You need to understand. That's why we are saying if we have a properly trained buyer, you should be able to pick that. If you don't have, it goes through. Okay, so the appreciate the process. So in the beginning, this particular person writes specification that are skewed to a certain person, and he puts demands, something like this, Grevazio, that maybe in supplying this table, for instance, I want to buy these tables, maybe 200 of these tables. Okay, then I put in the my specification and in my justification that this person should have supplied these particular tables before 4 times in the last 1 year. Okay, that's the specification coming from the end user, and that is already skewed the particular procurement process.
Because the buyer can overturn that, isn't it?
The buyer can advise.
The procurement officer can overturn that.
That's why we are saying
unrealistic demands.
That's why we are
from
saying
from the user units. And
that's right. That's why we are saying employ the right people. Okay. That's why I'm trying to tell you that government, you know, stands to gain, and private companies trying to gain if they employ the right people. So when this is done, what I'm trying to tell you, there's a certain times, Grevazio, I've worked in this profession almost all my life. Okay. So you are in the production, say, you know, in the plant. Okay. There's a particular motor that has failed, okay, and the end user deliberately fails to write a PR. I want you to listen to this, to raise the PR until you create a crisis. So then the MD comes to procurement people and says, how come I don't want the plant to stop, this motor I want it. Before long, somebody calls you, oh, Mr. Chibwe, I've got this motor. And you could say the end user, go check it out. He checks it out, it's a perfect motor. The question is, how did that person know? The question is, how would you buy an item that is only used for the plant in your house? So you see, from the beginning, there could be corruption there.
When you insist on having professionals in the field, another school of thought does not agree with you. For instance, during the time when people were just being pushed from other areas into stores, mm-hmm. and buying and mm-hmm. purchasing, mm-hmm. corruption was very low, minimal. But during a time when we have so many professionals, mm-hmm. corruption is rife.
Okay.
Isn't that a contradiction?
No.
You said you need to employ professionals.
You need to understand. I'll answer that question, but let me finish the thought first. I want you to appreciate that corruption is in the chain. Just hear me. So when the specification are done, it comes to a buyer. The buyer could do certain things as well, which is corrupt. One of the things the buyer can do is it can limit, for instance, the procurement process and say this particular threshold allows us to get quotation from anybody else and send out an inquiry and put 5 days. Instead of maybe a longer period, and only a few people can answer to that, and then you have one bid coming, and then the contract is awarded. You see, but then also you could have the evaluation panel. You know that the evaluation panel, you know, is set up by the organization to evaluate the bids. Okay, and there is actually the holy grail of contracting. There, you can have people that are particularly looking for a particular firm, and they are eliminating anyone else they want. You know, and sometimes you have a buyer there, sometimes you don't have a buyer. Because evaluation panel is specifically, you know, to certain skills that are in there. So there could be corruption there as well. You know, and people would tell her they are, you know, adding other things that were not there in the evaluation criteria so they can eliminate others. There could be corruption at tender committee, you know, where you have the HR person maybe is, you know, group thinking and calvinating everyone to think in the same direction, and you can go somewhere where it's not supposed to go. There could be corruption, Grevazio, by the engineer. You know, when you give this to a contract manager to run, the contract manager runs this contract, okay? I'm giving an example. Let's, for instance, you build some structure, right? And you have a contract manager. There's no buyer involved in that process. The contract manager goes to site and he says, you know, this particular building is not okay because the ratio of cement to sand or whatever was not correct, okay? So you have to bring down this building, okay? Then the contractor says, no, don't do, let's talk by the site, okay? The engineer approves that. The contract manager proves that. In fact, it is a documented truth that most of the corruption, Grevazio, takes place at contract administration process, where the buyer is not even part of it. Contract management, yes. What I'm saying, you're building a road, for instance. This road must have this thickness, right? Or this mixture of cement and sand and whatever it is. And the inspector goes to site and he checks and he finds that it's less than that, okay? And he says you have to rip off this 220 kilometers, okay? Have you ever seen that happen? Somebody's going to say, no, don't do that. Let's talk. See, there's corruption there. There could be corruption at the payment stage. You know, the finance people would say, your invoice is ready. It's ready in the next 30 days. But talk to me nicely. I'll pay you next week. Okay, the inefficiencies that appear in this process actually encourages corruption.
So the whole process seems to be really infested by corruption. How does the nation get this and get out of this?
That's what I'm saying, Grevazio.
It seems to be a big mess.
It is. That's what I'm saying. There's corruption there, but it's never resident in the buyer. It is in the process. So you find that
the buyer is part.
Yeah, like anybody else is part of. I'll tell you, Grevazio. in the you know, procurement committee, you know, a buyer is a secretary. The chairman is a CEO or the permanent secretary. You see, he influences nothing. Okay, so the issue of tackling corruption, Grevazio, is a bigger issue than simply pointing at a buyer. As a matter of fact, if you do that, you're not solving the problem.
Now,
the entire supply chain needs to be checked. The entire value chain process needs to be checked.
Before I ask you for the solution, I want you to look at this issue. What happens? Controlling officers and CEOs are dragged to court, some of them jailed. Mm-hmm. Buyers are never taken to court. Too smart?
No.
Wrong advice?
No. This, you know, this is what I'm saying, Grevazio, that focusing your mind and your energies on buyers, you miss the target. Okay? Because he's not the only one who can do wrong things. Okay? Some people can decide, because I'm CEO, I want this contract to do it. Bring the contract, I sign. The act doesn't say that. You can't sign before the Attorney General checks it. You can't sign before you do the procurement process. But you see, the buyer can go to the you know, controlling officer and say, sir, you know, you can't do this. But that buyer has no legitimate power. That buyer is the most junior in that organization. How can you influence his CEO? How can you influence the permanent secretary? That's why we've been advocating, Grevazio, that you need to elevate this position, because then your voice can be heard. Then your voice can, you can say, no, sir, because you've got legitimate power. You know, most of the time we have expert power, for instance, but you have no legitimate power in these organizations. And if you need to police this entire supply chain, the buyer must be sufficiently, must have enough power to actually advise and be endeavors be taken up in this organization. So concluding my comment in this, yes, there's corruption, but it's resident in the process.
So why is this procurement process, particularly the public procurement process, so prone to corruption?
No.
Vulnerable to corruption?
No.
Because of huge sums of money in there?
No. Any procurement process, any procurement around the world is prone to corruption because of the money is involved. Okay. But to say there's only corruption in public procurement and there's no corruption in private you know, procurement is not a correct statement. The only issue is that people are focused on public procurement, but there is more in public sector, in private sector. Because, see, certain mining, for instance, mining companies, they don't follow any procurement process, legitimate ones. They're not under an act. They just, you know, decide to bring any firm from anywhere because that person is my friend, and the CEO can impose it, or anybody else can impose it on the procurement process. And we have nowhere to go because, first of all, you are not regulated. And you don't even have an act that controls that act, you know, that process, besides the fact that a buyer must be legitimate. But I'll tell you something, Grevazio. You know, there is an act, you know, Minerals Act, you know, that demands that all mining firms that operate in Zambia must get their materials from local firms, from materials that are resident in Zambia. Second, they must get, you know, suppliers who are citizen registered in Zambia. It's in the Act, Minerals Act of 2015. But do they do that? They don't. You see, the buyer would go to the CEO and say, sir, but we can't source from South Africa. The Act says, source from Zambia. The next time you come, you have a letter telling you to go home. That's why we are saying, you see, in ZIPS, you go to ZIPS and say, look, we are amending the Act, so that we can actually go there and influence the processes, even in private sector. But you know, in the private sector, where, you know, CEOs make unilateral decisions, we have to follow some kind of a process.
And private ZIPS sector, that's their money. Whether they don't use it wisely, that shouldn't really worry the public, should it?
No.
But public financing, public funds, these are sacred funds. Okay. Which should be protected and ring-fenced.
Let me answer it this way. Public procurement, obviously, has to have a very rigid process because they're dealing with taxpayers' money, okay, and the amount of money spent are huge. But let me remind you, the Act, ZIPS Act of 2003, does not differentiate whether that buyer is in private or in public. So our mandate goes across any person who is buying in Zambia, regardless of where they work for. Okay, that's why I'm telling you that we need to go in the private sector as well. The only reason why public procurement is on scrutiny is that when they do the Auditor General's report, for instance, it goes public. But when KPMG does a report on the mines, no one knows about it. But even there, there are issues. And I'll tell you something why we need to control that. Because look, in the mines, they come and tell you that we are firing so many, 60,000 of our workers, because we're making a loss, because the copper price has come down. Okay? Now, they are making that loss because the procurement is not done properly. You know, the cost of doing business, you know, the production cost is high, because somewhere in procurement there's inefficiencies. Because if they had developed that process, they would not have fired those people. So government gains in that process by having people employed, and Zambians gain in that process. So we are interested in the mines too, we are, even if they are money. But the issue is they have to do the undertake properly, because then if those companies are making losses, you know, there are no taxes coming out of that system. Who loses? Is it them or is it us? It's us. That's why we are going to those mines to deal with it as well.
Now when you look at public procurement, evidence of corruption, which is sometimes very visible, is an issue where almost all the goods of in public procurement are very expensive, extremely expensive. You would build a three-story building for a small amount of money, and government would not build a 1x3 classroom block in a rural area for a huge amount of money. Yeah. Why is that so?
Look, that problem is endemic in the public procurement process, because you see, this is why we say, you know, we've had some people complain about the procurement process taking long. You see, if you shorten that, that's what happens. If you lengthen that, you make sure that you get in people around the world to come in and participate in the tender, and then you reduce the price. It is a given fact that if you go to public tender, you know, and you go competitive bidding, you reduce your cost by 20%. If you go straight to somebody direct bidding, it gains. But here's the problem. I work for a company called Millennium Challenge Account Zambia. I don't know if you've heard about that. You know, we are doing these drainages in the city of Lusaka, and the water recirculation system, you know, funded by the American government and Zambian government. Our procurement process, Grevazio, is second to none, if I may say that way. One of the things that we do is a phenomenon we call price reasonableness analysis. What happens is that when you finish the tender process, okay, in our laws that we use, because our procurement process, we don't use PPA, right? We use what's called PPG. It's actually part of the act in Zambia to use that. But in there, there's a demand for us to come back and review your price before you award. Okay? So what you would do is this. Okay, you are the most, best evaluated bidder. But when you look at your price, it's double than what happens in the region. It forces us to go to the region and check also what others are offering. And if it's a vehicle, for instance, or if it's a phone that you are buying, we'll go on Google and find out the actual price. And we need to challenge you and say, look, this particular price is higher. But what we do is we won't speak to you. We'll just drop you. So if the guy who is quoting properly is number 8, we'll find him and award him. Now, that process, what you call price reasonableness analysis, makes us, all our procurement at the MCA, have been under budget.
So why isn't this happening in other public procurement processes?
That's one of the issues that we would want to recommend, you know, to be done in public procurement. But even the act itself, as it speaks today, it allows us to check that. Okay? Where you can actually say, look, why should we, you know, because we need to compare with the budget that was actually given. Okay? We need to look at engineer's estimate for that particular job. You can't go beyond that. You can't go beyond that. We can't say, you know, what was budgeted for, you know, because of Indian estimate is 200 million. We can't award that 600 million. You can't. See, so that is also a process that needs to be strengthened, even in our procurement process, in managing that. And then also, one of the issues, and it also appears in all international, because our procurement process follows what is called UNISTRO, you know, which is international, United Nations international procurement laws. Okay? It doesn't allow negotiation when you go to public tender. You can't negotiate a price in public tender. The understanding, Grevazio, is that you are given sufficient time to contract with the world to get the best price. So you can't go and negotiate that price. See, but what you can check in a post-analysis is where that particular price is beyond what was actually budgeted for. Because the act does demand. Before you do that, you check the budget. You check the availability of funds. Okay? So the issues of us giving out tenders before you check the budget or above budget shouldn't be happening.
Okay. Now, the head of state did direct the Zambia Public Procurement Authority, ZPPA, to expedite the publication of benchmark prices, particularly in areas of high value spending, so that the nation could get value for the money. Mm-hmm. How will this help?
Look, one of the issues that we have is that you can have you know, a department, maybe Minister of Finance, undertaking a tender, and they are buying paper, for instance, okay, and they buy that paper, that particular ream of paper, maybe at 200 kwacha. The next ministry will be sending out another inquiry in the same market, you know, and getting a price at 60. Okay, so there are these variations. What the head of state was saying, which is very correct, which ZPP has taken up, is can't we benchmark these rates? Why is it that I am offering more in Mwense, you know, and less in Samfia, for argument's sake? You see, it can't be. It's the same government. So ZPP has taken it up very seriously, you know, the consultant, to try and come up with rates, you know, that are going to guide that process. It's actually similar to the point I was making, the price reasonable analysis, you know, where you're going to have, you know, term contracts. You know, if you are supplying government, you know, maybe Lwapula province, you have one rate across Lwapula province. That is a very, very important aspect. And also, it happens not even in government, but even in that organization as well. You find that in an organization that has many, you know, maybe private company, but has many sections, you find this buying team is buying something different from the other buying team. And what the president was saying is a very important aspect, and ZPP and ZPT have taken up very seriously to make sure that we have a benchmark for this price.
Will this take away the aspect of willful theft and wanton abuse of authority, of office?
No, wanton
abuse of resources and funds.
Then I did mention to you that it's in the chain, okay. And but what we'll
do? What is the solution? We are looking at this big chain, which has been affected by fraud.
Okay.
So by fraudsters.
Okay. First of all,
masquerading as probably as civil servants.
Okay.
And genuine members of staff and buyers. But
okay.
Where is the solution?
First, what the head of state said is very critical in managing the cost. You know, government spend, because then we'll not have those variations, and somebody has to keep to, you know, a properly tendered out price. Because another thing, just before I answer that, another thing that you must bear in mind, Revisor, is if I'm a unit that is buying paper, for instance, and I want 10 reams, Revisor, and then you want to buy maybe 1,000 reams, you know, the price is going to be different. Okay, so it's putting together all these requirements and do one big tender so that somebody can give you, you know, economies of scale, give you a price that is better, as opposed to just doing things anyhow, you know, somehow every section is doing a different thing. Because if I'm trying to, you are buying 10 rims and I must travel here to Mwense, it's going to cost you, I'm going to add the value of my traveling there, you see, because even the amount is not that enough to allow economies of scale. So what the president is saying is very critical in managing the eventual cost of doing business. But let me answer the question that you put across. The act is very clear on most of these things, okay? And if we followed to the letter what the act say, would reduce most of these corrupt issues.
So who has failed in here? Is it ZIPS?
The chain.
Or is it your professionals that have failed to defend
the
values
and the law? It's a chain. So what we believe...
What I'm trying to say is you blame this chain.
Mm-hmm.
And it's too huge. Mm-hmm. It's a long chain. And how do you address an issue affecting a chain?
Okay.
But let's start from your institutions. I'm Minister of Pension and Supply. Have you failed as a profession to defend the values of your profession?
No, we've not.
To advise?
We've not. Actually... we've taken up very seriously. One of the things that we must do as a way forward, and we have advised this government at various levels, is that when a permanent secretary, for instance, comes to the, you know, runs a ministry, he himself or herself must be trained in public procurement. Everyone else in the process must appreciate the process. That's why some people go to lengths of making sure all their controlling officers are aware about the process. Because sometimes the controlling officers don't just want to do wrong things. They're genuinely not aware of what they need to do. You see, we've allowed them to continue doing that. So one of the recommendations we make is that we want to have open public secretaries trained. We want all engineers trained in public procurement. Every person must have this document here as their Bible, you know, and know what they cannot do and what they cannot do. Most of the people that could be convicted in this, some of them would be genuinely not knowing what to do. For instance, Foreign Service, you know, people that go in the Foreign Service, they are trained, you know, I think some institutions will train them, but no one is trained in public procurement. But they'll be doing, you know, public procurement in there. They'll be doing, you know, and it has a lot of problems in there. One of the solutions that we recommend at ZIPS is government must ensure that every civil servant is actually trained in public procurement. And ZIPS has designed the program for that, you know, where we can have a quick appreciation of public procurement processes, you know, and procurement in general, because most of them play a part in that particular process. Second is to ensure that our members, Grevazio, are trained enough to be able to understand the process. And so we have also, at ZIPS, have many programs that are running right now where we go back in service, bring these people back there, tell them about the process, and let them begin to understand what they need to do in that particular process.
You have a code of ethics that guides your members?
Yes, we have a code of ethics.
What does it say?
It has many, many things that you do, you know, but it defines exactly do's and don'ts. So a buyer should be able to know, if I did that, I'll be against my code of conduct.
But
if
this
I
is not that, publicized. So no one
it is publicized.
No one even reports it reports is. To you that
No, it is publicized. In fact, we have two things. Let me tell you. One, we have Miss Eve Jala, I mentioned to you, we've been getting somebody, because previously, as ZIPS, we've been using CIPS code of conduct, okay? Which we adopted in 2003. We use that one up to now. But then 2 years ago, we engaged Mrs. Jala to define a new code of conduct, okay, which we are doing. But ZPPA also had undertaken code of conduct, which they gave to us, which the vice president actually gave me in person, that I should go and make sure that that particular one is adhered to. So what we are doing now, we are developing the code of conduct for private sector. But at the moment, we have the code of conduct that was signed by the president, as a matter of fact, and members are abiding by that. And we also have a CIPS code of conduct, and members are abiding by that.
Let's talk about
and
reform.
And that's what we use when you're checking your conduct, when you are reported on ZIPS.
But how do I report if I don't know what is contained in the code of ethics? Code of conduct?
No. To report a buyer? Because it's publicized. I mean, it says you can go on the ZPPA website, you'd find the code of conduct. You find it on ZIPS code of conduct. We have conducted trainings on the code of conduct on many meetings on the Copper Belt with contractors, with different players. And even this year, we have scheduled to go and conduct more trainings. Just that you don't want to come and cover that. And more trainings on the demands and the dictates of the code of conduct. And another thing, Grevazio, before I forget this point. One of the things that we need to do to manage this process, Grevazio, is that in as much as corruption is in the chain, but if you empowered the buyer, you deal with most of these issues. That's why I was saying that we need to have legitimate power by the person who is managing this process. Because if you go to your CEO, I give that example, you go to your CEO and try to challenge him and you're a junior officer, it won't happen. If I want to see you as a director, I'll speak with you at a certain level. You see? So that's why we feel that government, if they really want to deal with this issue, they must promote the function of public procurement and, you know, even in private companies. That's when you're going to see these values coming out. Then you have the legitimate power. You may have referent power. You may even have expert power, but you don't have legitimate. I'll tell you an example. Give you examples in some of these organizations, right? Like government today has employed a lot of people in the supply chain who are not registered by us, as I speak to you. Okay? So government. Come again?
You've engaged them?
Yes, we're engaging them. We're engaging them very strongly.
There have been instances where ZPPA has cancelled a tender and clearly it is shown that the buyer has made a mistake. Do you intervene in such cases to try and punish the buyer?
We've never had that cases reported to us.
Some of these are public tenders, very big tenders.
Well, I've only known one which we took up, but we have never taken up those kind of issues. But in fact, yesterday, we signed a memorandum of understanding between ZPPA and ZIPS. And one of the issues is how do we, you know, bridge this gap? Okay? You seem to be driving in one direction. ZPPA is a regulator. ZIPS is an enforcer of that. You know, ZIPS looks at the person who is buying. ZPPA looks at how that person is doing it. But there's never been a collaboration in the two institutions. So we signed a memorandum of understanding, and one of the issues is actually that. How do you collaborate? If they find an issue with a certain buyer, ZIPS comes in and they deal with that particular issue and dispense of it. And ZIPS has a mandate of training. ZPPA should be doing any training through ZIPS. That's what the Act said. Okay, so in ZIPS Act and the Public Procurement Act of 2008, there's a mention that every person who works in public procurement must abide by ZIPS Act. So both support each other. You see, so but how do we work together in this compliance? How do we make sure that people that are doing the wrong things, instead of ZPP trying to deal with them with an inadequate mandate, ZIPS can deal with them? So we signed a memorandum of understanding. We invited you, you didn't come.
I want you to look at the issues of reform.
That's happening.
Issues
now,
of reforms. Issues of reforms. What do you want to see changed in the procurement process? It takes too long. People complain. That by the time the deal is done, the year is over, and some funds are returned to the Treasury.
Okay.
Can we shorten the procurement process, public procurement process?
You know, Grevazio, before I answer that one, I want to take you through the process and why people say it's long. They actually follow the Act. Okay. First, you have the solicitation document done. You have to advertise that solicitation document. I told you initially that public procurement is premised on the fact that you are contracting with the world. So you need to give them enough time to prepare the document. Because this is what happens. If I and the Act says it must be four weeks, you know, for local bidding and 6 weeks for international bidding. The reason, Grevazio, is that if you give me a tender, say I'm tendering for the road at RDA, and I don't understand certain portion because you've given me a shorter period, you know, I need to clarify with the organization what does this mean, and they need to respond in writing. But if I don't have that time, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to put a price that is higher. You know, contractors have a natural propensity to putting a price that will cover them. Okay, if something is vague, I'm going to make sure that if in the tender there is a supply of a car, okay, and you haven't told me what that car is, you know, and if I'm the one preparing that bid, I'm going to make sure that I put a Mercedes-Benz or the most expensive car, just in case that's what you're looking for. So the issues of giving them time to clarify and be able to work on the tender properly is an important aspect, and you can't shorten that. So we have 4 weeks in which to do that. When that is done, there's an evaluation panel. The evaluation panel is going to make sure that they look at this bid to make sure that what this person is saying is actually what they are not supposed to be, you know, what is they're supposed to be doing. I'll give an example. There are certain tenders where a construction company is very crafty, because these people have got people that do tenders for them, and they hide things in there. It would say something like, you know, you're supposed to do so many things, right? And I put a clause somewhere inside a document, thick like this, and I write somewhere and say, I exclude this price, exclude that. If the evaluation panel rushes through that, they will award the contract. The first day this firm comes on site, it's going to tell you, that was excluded, can you do a variation, can you do an amendment? And I worked in the mines for a long time under contract, and you find that your contract was 2 million. By the time it finishes, it's 20 million. Everything that you thought was in there has been excluded. So the evaluation process takes 14 days. It's an important process to do, you see. Because if you don't
together,
do that,
you're probably already taking 40 days.
No, I'll tell you. It takes eight days. It takes 88 days to 103 days, you see, in the particular procurement process, you see. And that is 3.5 months it takes. If you came to my organization, we do...
Meaning in the entire public procurement process, you probably have 8 months?
That's why you need to plan, Grevazio. That's why you need to plan. But let me finish the point. So what happens is that once that is done, the evaluation panel is going to meet. Okay? I mean, and then the procurement committee must meet. Now, when they award that, we allow what is called 10-day standing time. You know, that period is to allow you to debrief, to say, why didn't I win this tender? What am I supposed to be doing in this tender? And you allow you. And if you are aggrieved by any other issue, you can beat challenge. So you allow that 10 days. By which we inform we are going to give the contract, and you have 10 days in which to react or to debrief in that process. And then after that, you have 14 days by which the contract needs to be signed. Now, when you add all that, it gives you about 102 days. But
can it be shortened? We're running out of time.
Let me say something very briefly, and
we close.
Okay.
Can it be shortened?
Yes, it can be shortened. And one issue
and we
that
can
is
still get
that,
value for
that. What, one thing that is actually missing there. There's also the Attorney General. The Attorney General must sign and check every contract.
That's an additional 2 months.
Might take 2 months. Might take five months.
So you add up to 5 months for a public procurement.
So there's things that can be done to this. We think that with appropriate people in the process, we can shorten the process. We can also maybe look at the Auditor General's, you know, the Attorney General's requirement. Instead of it going there, maybe employ more people or allow quasi-organization to, you know, to review the contract on behalf of government, or even let them come up with a standard document, a standard contract that they can approve and it can be used without it going back to the, you know, to the system. So one of the things that we are doing, Grevazio, is also bringing the e-procurement. That's going to deal with most of these issues.
Mr. Mwelwa, it's been a pleasure having you on the show.
Pleasure, man. Thanks a lot.
You've been watching Sunday Interview, and this evening our guest was the Zambia Institute of Purchasing and Supply President, Mr. Chibwe Mwelwa. Till next week at the same time, pleasant viewing.